Hello dear fans, friends and subscribers, this is your host Ram welcoming you to your daily edition of the Cricket Happening Show. And on this Cricket Happening Show, well, the interest was definitely centered around whether Kushal Mendes, who played a wonderful knock yesterday, would reach his maiden double ton, but it was unfortunately not to be. But definitely Kushal Mendes will remember this test for sure, as he collected 176 runs. And the Sri Lankan tail also wagged a bit, especially Rangana Herath, who hit a few boundaries and caught the Sri Lankan total to a score of 353, thus setting Australia a target of 268 to win the match. And of the 268 runs, Australia have already wiped off 83 runs, but in the process they have lost 3 wickets to the spinners. And tomorrow promises to be a very, very promising day of cricket. Can't get any better, with Australia requiring 185 runs to win the match and Sri Lanka requiring 7 wickets. And definitely one would feel, especially considering that the ball is going to be heavier than the bat tomorrow because of the spinner Sandakan, who still Australians are struggling to read, and also Rangana Herath with all his wiles as an experienced spinner. I think Australia would have that task cut out. Even getting 185 runs is going to be very difficult on this pitch, and especially considering it's going to be on the final day. So I'll be talking about that match. So this is what the situation is. And as far as the New Zealand and Zimbabwe match goes, today was day 3 there at Bulawayo in the first test match, day 2, sorry. And New Zealand replied with 315 for 4, with Tom Latham making a century, and this was the same ground where his father Rod Latham has also made a century. And Kane Williamson, just out before close of play, the captain in his first test match, probably could have got as a captain of the New Zealand team for the test match for the first time, could have probably got a century under his belt. Does not to be. He was dismissed for 91 just before close of play. And New Zealand are definitely dictating terms. We are 315 for 4 with 151 runs ahead. And also tomorrow we have the start of the test match, which is starting between the second test match between India and West Indies. And West Indies probably have strengthened their party with a lot of pace. So Miguel Cummins might play tomorrow, Shannon Gabriel, so we might have a 3-pronged pace attack, and that is very vital, as they say that Samana Park, Jamaica, could have a different texture as far as the pitch is concerned. So tomorrow is the second test match between India and West Indies. I don't think I'll be having time to preview it, but I will try my best. But let's start off. So let's head on to Palakkale in Sri Lanka and see what really happened. So as I said, all eyes were on Kushal Mendes, whether he can get to the coveted maiden double ton. It was not to be. In fact, he was the first wicket to go today in the morning, one could say. Because he was the one who was the victim Mitchell Starc, as he was caught by Neville. But after contributing 176 runs, he hit one more boundary today, 21 fours and 1 6. But what a knock from Kushal Mendes. After that, there were very good contributions coming in. Pereira was out for 12 LBW ball Hazelwood, but Rangana Herath was the one who hit it out with 6 fours in a knock of 35 runs. And that is the reason that Sri Lanka managed to reach a score of 353 all out, thus setting Australia a target of 268 runs to win the first test match. So Rangana Herath definitely played a very, very important knock there, 35. Rangana Herath was out to Hazelwood for 35. Sandakan was clean bowled by Starc. He didn't know anything about the delivery from Starc. He was gone for 9, 2 boundaries. Pradeep was not out on 10, 2 boundaries. 353 all out was the final tally for the Sri Lankans. And as I said, the wicket takers, Mitchell Starc had 4 for 84, 2 for 59 Hazelwood, 2 for 108 for Nathan Lyon, 1 for 42 for... And Steve O'Keefe, let me tell you, that's bad news for Australia for sure, because Steve O'Keefe has been doing very well, unfortunately won't take any part in the remainder of the series. And a left-arm spinner by the name John Holland, who has been doing very well in the Australian domestic tourneys, has been roped in. So he's the one who's going to replace Steve O'Keefe as a left-arm spinner, and that's going to be pretty interesting. And so one feels very sorry for Steve O'Keefe, unfortunately due to injury. he's flying back to Australia. So as far as Australia are concerned, so all eyes were on Australian openers, Joe Burns and David Warner, who walked in. And well, it seemed like Australia definitely had decided that aggression is the best form of defense. And in the process, it was Ranganathan who was actually sharing the new ball, as I said, with Noah Pradeep. And Ranganathan struck very quickly as he forced David Warner to dance down the wicket, which he did. And in the process, he lost his stumps. He didn't get into the line of the ball, and Ranganathan was the victor. David Warner was the victim. Bowled Bharat for one, and that was wicket number one, and not a good start for Australia at all after losing the big wicket of David Warner. And after that, Usman Khawaja and Joe Burns started slowly nurdling their way. But in the process, what they were doing was that, as I said, they had decided probably the mindset was to show aggression. And in the process, we saw Joe Burns and Burns also hit a 6-2. And Khawaja was also looking good with 3-4s. And the score had reached 33. And that was the time it was Dilruan Pereira who picked up the wicket as another spinner, as he actually had Usman Khawaja sweeping at the delivery. But Usman Khawaja failed to connect, and up went the umpire's finger as he was trapped by LBW in front of the wicket. He was gone for 18 with 3 boundaries. And then Joe Burns, after playing well for his 29, 2-4s and 1-6, was a victim, as it was Sandakan getting his first wicket of the second innings. As Sandakan Sandakan was very Lakshan Sandakan was very difficult to read, and the Australian batsmen were really struggling to read him. And I think he's going to be the key tomorrow on a very I'm sure it's a fifth day wicket, so it's going to be a deteriorating wicket. And I think Australia have their task really cut out. I thought Australians have to show some real superior skills to get out of this situation. So Joe Burns was out for 29 with 2-4s and 1-6. And after that, we saw towards the close, Stephen Smith, and as I said, bad light stop play as usual, as has been happening in this particular test series, as Stephen Smith was not out on 26, the skipper. But one thing that they realized after the 3 wickets were gone, that Australia realized that there was no point in going and trying to play aggressively. And Stephen Smith realized that very quickly, and he slowly buckled down to the task as he scored 26 without a boundary and a 6. And Adam Voges, there was a confident appeal for LBW, but Adam Voges stayed on. He was not out on 9 with 1 boundary as Australia closed a bad light stop play. On the 4th day, the Australian score read 83 for 3, thus meaning that 185 runs still needed for Australia on the morrow, on the final day, to actually win the test match, and Sri Lanka will need another 7 wickets. So looking at what the situation is right now, I can say it is tomorrow is the final day that they are going to play. As you know, the 5th day's play, there will be a lot of wear and tear, and I'm sure the ball is going to do some tricks for sure. And Lakshan Sandakan, let me tell you, even on a wicket which was not helping, he did well. But now, if the wicket is going to deteriorate, I'm sorry to say, Australians have to really play out of their skins tomorrow. It's not going to be easy. Sandakan would be the key there, as he finished with 5 overs on mid and 1 for 13. Dilruan Pereira, 9 overs on mid and 1 for 19. Ranganathan had 10 overs on mid and 1 for 35. And 3 overs for 16 for Noah Pradeep. So, as I said, for Australia to get out of the situation tomorrow, if at all they have to get 185 runs, they have to combat the spin of Ranganathan, Dilruan Pereira and Sandakan in particular. As I said, the Australians are still finding it a struggle to read the spin of Sandakan, and he could be the main threat for the Aussies tomorrow. Ranganathan for sure with his experience, but Sandakan I think would be the main threat tomorrow. So that is as far as the match between Australia and Sri Lanka is concerned. So the match is nicely set up, so hopefully one hopes that the rain gods stay away, and we have an engrossing game of cricket coming up tomorrow, and should be a nice battle to watch, no doubt about it. So that is as far as Palakkale is concerned. Now let's head on to Bulawayo, Queen Sports Club in Bulawayo, where New Zealand replying to the Zimbabwean total yesterday of 264. Tom Latham and Kane Williamson started off and they started piling in a partnership. This partnership yielded 160 odd runs between Tom Latham and Kane Williamson, with Kane Williamson showing his class, but also both Tom Latham and Williamson not really taking anything for granted, but slowly settling down on that wicket and slowly playing. Latham was really waiting for the loose balls to hit. Kane Williamson, on the other hand, was also playing some classic strokes, as he's wont. But as I said, Kane Williamson, it was his first test match as a captain, test match as a captain. So that would have given him, and both actually stitched together a partnership as they took, they lost Guptill today early in the morning. He was the first wicket to go, as Martin Guptill, after making 40 with 7 fours, got an edge onto a ball of Chibaba. He was gone. And definitely, I thought the Zimbabwean bowling was also a bit crippled, because they lost Sean Williams, and they also lost one more bowler in the mix, which was sad. And definitely, it was not so easy for them, as both Taylor and the bowler was not there, if I'm not wrong, whether it was Chinoya, I'm not really sure, or Trepano probably. Kane Williamson, as I said, Tom Latham went on to score a century. He made 105 with 12 boundaries, as I said. His father, Rod Latham of New Zealand, also made a century there. So that is a sort of a good feeling for Tom Latham, like father, like son, one could say. And then Kane Williamson, towards the close of play, was dismissed for 91 by his opposite number, which is the Zimbabwean captain, Graham Creamer, who toiled hard. I thought Graham Creamer was the one who really toiled hard. 91 runs with 9 fours. Trepano came in, and with the new ball, he picked up the wicket of Henry Nicholls for 18 with 2 boundaries. And then Ross Taylor was not out on 38 at close of play on the second day with 5 boundaries. He showed he was not out on 5, as New Zealand closed at 315 for 4 on the second day of the first test match against Zimbabwe. And the bowling, well, 1 wicket for 113 for Creamer, who really bowled the maximum number of overs today. Tenor was 1 for 22. I thought Chibaba took that important wicket of Guptill. And Masakadza, 9 overs on, made him 1 for 25, picking up an important wicket too of Latham, the Centurion. So definitely Zimbabwe have a long way to go here, but New Zealand definitely looking completely in command right now at 315 for 4, already taken a 151 runs lead. Now, the next thing that I'm going to look at, dear fans, is tomorrow, as I said, it's going to be the match between India and West Indies. Tomorrow is going to be the second test match. The first test match was won by India pretty easily. It was an innings defeat for the West Indies. Now, everything will shift on to the India versus West Indies second test match. It's going to be played at Savannah Park, Kingston in Jamaica. And I can tell you that the West Indies, and it seems like this pitch is going to help the pace bowlers. So India for sure will be going with the winning four pace, but definitely India has some injury worries. Murali Vijay is definitely going to be replaced, so KL Rahul might get his opportunity, because Vijay is ruled out with the injury, and that could be the only change for India. And as far as, let's look out for Alzari Joseph, who has been clocking at 140s in the Under-19 World Cup, and he's the one who really packs some aggression in his bowling. So I think we are going to see some raw pace tomorrow from West Indies, and that would be great to see, according to me, after quite a long time, with Shannon Gabriel, Miguel Cummins, I would say no one is so experienced, and Alzari Joseph is an absolute rookie as far as this. So Alzari Joseph and Miguel Cummins could well make their debut, and one does not know which are the players who are going to be probably dropped. Probably they are going to drop a batsman, one does not know. And I won't be surprised if West Indies go on to drop a batsman, because as I said, this pitch is supposed to really help the pace bowler, Savannah Park, Kingston in Jamaica. And I think we are in for a real battle. Even India definitely has the pace resources up, no doubt about it. So I think it should be a real battle. Probably the battle could get a bit equal tomorrow at Savannah Park, Kingston in Jamaica. So till such time that happens, let's wait for it. And tomorrow I'll be back with my next Cricket Happening show, talking on all these three matches. Till such time that happens, this is your host Ram, signing off for the day. Thank you.